Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. I'll take the roll.
Turn your sound up, turn your volume all the way down. You don't want to play your sound frequency up.
What's that? Okay. All right, thank you. All right. See you about. Yeah. Catherine Emery is out today. She is at her first class. Tim West?
Tim's here.
Hi. Joe Petrosky?
I'm not here.
I am here. Emery? And Kirk, yeah, okay. All right, are there any adjustments to the agenda?
No, ma'am.
Okay. So, in consideration of minutes, I will entertain a motion to approve the minutes of the Winthrop School Committee meeting of January 5th, 2022, as written or with corrections.
So moved.
Tim, can you second?
Second.
Thank you. Is there any discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? Okay. Reports. Superintendent report.
I sent my report out in advance, and most of the stuff that is in there for discussion is coming up under another spot in the agenda under old business. So the only other thing I want to add, you can ask me questions if you want, is that I talked to Mr. Campbell today. He will be doing interviews for the new Spanish teacher, which will undoubtedly be remote, right? Yeah.
Any questions about that?
Sure.
The students that have been taking Spanish, who have rearranged their schedule for the second semester, are they going to be able to keep that rearranged schedule, or are they going to be expected to stay in Spanish? Did you hear me?
I did. I'm just trying to figure out
I'll give you an example. My youngest daughter was in a Spanish class, and so she's kind of flipped her schedule a little bit to rearrange everything before she took up PE 2 and changed her tutorial and all that stuff, thinking that there wasn't going to be Spanish for the second semester.
Mm-hmm.
So will she have to go back to the Spanish, or will they just, how's that going to work?
So this whole idea was what we call out-of-box thinking, you know?
Yep.
So we're still in that process because, you know, ideally it would be nice if they could come in and tweak to the schedule that we have, but if it's not doable, then we're going to try to do something so that she's able to, or he's able to, present to the students. It'll be similar to, I think Brooke's taken an online class, right?
Yes.
So we're going to do something, you know, might be hybrid, where there's going to be some face-to-face interaction through a Zoom,
okay,
and there's going to be other sessions where the students are actually doing activities online completely alone.
Okay.
So we're still trying to build this.
Okay. But it won't be, obviously it won't be for the beginning of the third quarter.
We're hoping to have it sometime next week.
Oh, okay.
Yep.
All
I
right.
hope to have through. A name for the superintendent tomorrow.
Okay. Thank you. All right.
I don't really have much to say in my report at this point. Thanks for being here. Those of you that can in person or online, I appreciate it. As a quick reminder, if you are online, please have your first and last names visible. And throughout the meeting, if you have comments that you'd like to make, please put in the chat box, "I would like to make a comment." And our moderator will let us know that there's somebody that'd like to say something. Thank you for that. I think from there we'll just move on to committee reports.
Did you want, did you have, can you do any assignments to talk about?
So I've only heard back from one person about committee assignments in email. One of the things that Catherine wanted to know is if she could be on the curriculum committee. And I told her that I would get back to her on that because I wasn't sure how that would work since I was part of that. I don't remember that goes. So we'll need to discuss that and figure that out.
Yeah, great question. Thank you. Yes, that's a great question.
Otherwise, she would like to be on the policy committee, which I think makes a lot of sense.
Yeah, I think we were supposed to figure you should want to be there.
Yeah.
So as far as I'm concerned, I can just go in for where you have that.
Okay. All right. And it sounds like Tim wanted to stay on policy and on finance.
Okay. So I can have Tim choose that. If he wants to stay on policy, I would bow out so Catherine could be on it. But, and I can do one.
Okay.
I think Tim and I will kind of coordinate that.
Okay.
But I can be flexible and do whatever.
All right. That sounds good. Thank you.
Sure.
Thank you. All right. Is there any report from the Finance Committee this week?
Well, we were going to meet today at 4, but due to illness, we have to reschedule.
Okay. And policy is the same.
Yeah, we're going to meet at 5, but due to, due to the illness, we had to reschedule. Not funny, but.
Okay. For negotiations, we have met with the union twice so far and have gone from first page to the last page of the support service contract, and we've said what we wanted to see changed, added, removed, updated, and they have also said that for each article. So at our next full group meeting, we'll start actually hammering things out. Our next full group meeting is the last chance openly that we can bring things to the table to be changed. Otherwise, we have to have agreement on both sides to make any suggestions after that. We are meeting, we're scheduled to meet tomorrow as a small group, just Jim, Joe, and I, to discuss how we feel about everything that was brought to the table so that we have a better idea when we go and meet with them in 2 weeks, next week. And I suspect that the union is also doing the same thing. So that's where we are there. Curriculum.
Nothing to update.
Nothing, okay. Thank you.
Jim, how do we turn this off?
That I was trying to do. Joel, do you know how to... I think they fixed it. Now we know. Well, I did that. Anybody from Siemens know how to do that? Turn the bowls off. That's what I got from Frank, but it didn't hold that.
Thank you.
Yep. That doesn't really matter.
Administrator's reports.
They're in your packet.
They are in our packet. Does anybody have any questions, comments, or concerns that they'd like to bring up?
This is Fawcett, this is Pilot, what's the line? Ms. Rodri, and this is Boulet. Are all on?
Excellent.
I wanted to ask if the Kindness Crew book by the fourth grade is something that we might be able to look at someday, because that, and just looked like such a great idea. And I wanted to read their stories, and I absolutely love how Erin said that made her week to be able to do that with the kids.
Yeah.
To bring the pizza, so thank you.
Yes,
for your Randall.
Overall, I just want to say that I really love reading the administrator's reports and seeing all the great things that are happening across the district. I am really interested to hear more about the R and Dragons that is happening at the Winthrop Middle School. I'd love to hear more about that. I did have a couple of questions. I guess really just one One question for Joel. In your report, you were talking about having met with the University of Maine group, and that made me wonder, were there already concrete expectations anywhere for FMS, or was the expectation just to be here for 8 hours?
No, that's been requested. That's been requested probably since July, and not in September. So that was at no cost to the district.
Okay, thank you. So have you already met with FMS to give them the
Yes.
the list, and were they receptive to that, or?
Yeah, as far as, well, from my discussions, that's what they're doing now.
Okay.
It's been shared with the principal before. I shared it with FMS, so we did have support from that. Obviously, Jim was involved with that. And we've also forwarded it to the teachers, so they know what the expectation of their room is. Mike set up a ticketing program that they can send out also. So we started using this Monday, and we've already had quite a few. And we've been able to address them and pass them on to FMS also.
Excellent.
So, I will be very honest with you. When I did this position 4 or 5 years ago, my recommendation was not to continue with them. I had the same issues. Unfortunately, it was quite a bit of the FMS, you know, that the other principal got pulled into and had to be part of witnessing. But it's just, it hasn't gotten better. One of the main points that I'd like to make to you is that the reason I made the punch list and had a friend come in and help me do that was because that was the excuse I was given. We now have a foreman at the high school who's a great guy, but I want to say there's no issue with the workers that are put in a bad position. But until I brought it to their attention that they had someone that's been there only 6 months as a supervisor, that there was no punch list, there was nothing put in place to answer your question. So, you know, it's a very long-winded way as usual for me to explain to you that nothing was in place. That's why we put something in place, but it wasn't just because Joel was on it.
I didn't think so.
It was because this has happened so much that it was wasting more of my time dealing with them that if I just sucked it up and took 2 vacation days and did it.
And you may recall earlier we had a conversation about needing more time here at the grade school, and I made that request of the FMS owner, and told me they couldn't do that, but they could let us have another person for 7 additional hours a day at that cost. And I knew that it was pretty obvious it was time at the grade school, I mean at the middle school and high school, that could have been transferred over to here, and that wasn't an option. So we started looking a little bit deeper and realized that particularly at the high school, people who are working at night were leaving way early.
Yeah.
And I would like to see those hours come over here at the grade school where they need more help.
Yeah. The way this all started was in charge of maintenance.
So can you talk up a little bit?
The way it all started was being in charge of maintenance. I took over the Seacoast security contract, which is who is in charge of security systems entering the building. So I got a weekly print out when the building is open and when it's closed. And for 3 weeks straight, I was noticing FMS was leaving after 4 hours of work. When you compiled that with daily emails from staff, that there was issues not being dealt with, or during the excuse that we ran out of time, is when I involved Jim and said, I think you need to look at this. I will tell you that I have 2 different companies coming in next week to give me a bid. To take a look at that, but I am in strong support of putting people back in our buildings that are ours. This is the second company we've gone through with this, and we've just stayed with FMS because of their price tag, and we're definitely seeing that play out.
Thank you. So I did have another question for you. When do you expect the glycol system to be repaired or replaced?
we turn it on during lunch, it's very cold, but we can't leave it on, obviously, on cold nights like this, because now you're dealing with frozen pipe possibly, or we're already running too much oil in middle school, that's just going to be kind of rough.
Okay, great, thank you.
I have a couple things, yeah, okay. So Joel and Mike, I just loved that you guys worked together to make a ticketing system for everybody to communicate.
Yep.
Just sounds so smart to me, and I just love how you guys are working across the departments together. I just wanted to make that comment, so thank you guys.
Guys, I can't compliment Mike enough on it, I'm just going to be sitting over there, but it's really awesome, because it triggers a ton of emails, you can label, and the way it interacts, it's very easy, and it's very user-friendly for us.
It's a good tracking system, and
yep.
A good way to communicate for the staff to feel heard, I just think it's great. But. And then also, I wanted to ask you, flipping over, putting on your sports hat.
Yep.
What is the return to play protocol? Can you explain that to me a little bit more? Because I didn't know anything
sure.
about that.
So when the state reduced things to 5 days,
yeah.
The American Pediatrics folks got involved. And they were more comfortable with 10, because then a student athlete could return after a 10-day period allowing the body to heal. No surprise, the kids are wanting back out there as soon as possible. So we became proactive with that. Jeannie Ross brought to my attention that the pediatrics were still required in 10. So I contacted the main general, which is who we use, we contract our services for a trainer. They came up with a 3-day return. The number one thing that I really like about it is that it individually assesses a kid. You know, we've had some kids already that we've had to say you can go to your ECP and get cleared to come back because you still have, whether you're testing negative or not, you still have a hard time breathing, for example. But there's other kids that are just have a light touch of it, a cold, they come back, and they're able to just to either jump back in after 1 day or go through the 3 days. So to answer your question more directly, that is something that me in general came up to keep our student athletes safe.
Thank you. On the number one of that protocol, it says 5 days out with a positive negative test.
Yep.
A positive negative test?
Just a positive or negative test. So if you're out for 5 days, they're still going to have to do the return to protocol if you're negative at that point.
Okay.
If you're positive, then that gets into a whole different problem.
So I'm just a little bit concerned about the way that it's written here.
Sure.
Because it says with a positive negative test.
Yep. I think it should say positive or negative test. They're going to check you on day six if you're in school.
Regardless.
Regardless, yes.
Okay. I understand.
So
okay.
It's just to get a baseline of O2 with your question and see if you agree with it.
That makes sense. Thank you.
Okay.
Did you say Sue Fawcett on?
Sue is on.
Okay.
Yep.
Sue Fawcett, I have a quick question for you. Do you have any idea of what the amount is going to be for the main care reimbursement?
I have a call with Jason Black, who works for our vendor, and he and I are trying to determine if there are items that we can take off of the list for reimbursement. I don't have the letter with me. I want to say it's right around $12,000 is what they're asking for reimbursement back from us that they've already given. I have concerns of my own with that. Lots of little things like we've paid seed money on that. Are we going to recoup some of that seed money that we've already spent? Those kinds of things. The audit itself was looking at little things such as there wasn't a signature on an evaluation. And I really have a concern that we're being penalized for not having a signature. So Jason and I are working together to develop a letter that we're going to submit to the main care reimbursement folks to see if they can reduce that amount.
Great. Thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome.
All right. Tim or Joe have any questions that they wanted to share?
Joe's still on the line.
Okay.
Tim, do you have any questions?
No.
Thank you. Okay, so discussion. discussion about the performance contract.
Okay, let me introduce Carrie Warren and Eric Madsel, both from Siemens.
And hold this up and hand it here.
She's going to do the presentation, she's actually going to be up here. Want to move?
Great, I'm Carrie Warren. I am the performance contract lead for Maine for the K-12 market in Maine, New Hampshire. And we're going to kind of give an overview of the performance contracting process and then what we've seen for Winthrop schools and how that process would look for you guys. Start with, like I said, an introduction of performance contract, overview of how it would look for your schools, as well as our project process, and then touch quickly on the new infrastructure improvement funding that's going to be, it could potentially be a great benefit to your district, the project, and then how we would lay out your capital improvement plans, and then a Hoover workforce development program. In short, performance contract is a lease purchase that does not impact the taxpayers. So it is an energy savings project that is paid for through your current budget. So we will go through your buildings and look for capital measures, energy savings, and it is a payment to utility providers that we use for savings. So we'll do what we call low-hanging fruit with lighting, for example, building envelope, and those savings will help pay for other larger measures. So it is net zero to your budget. It's not going to cost you going out to taxpayers to increase your school district budget. It's also guaranteed. We guarantee the savings as well as the performance. That means we do not do change orders throughout the process. Once we start a project, everything is on Siemens then. So it also does sole sourcing. When you go out for RFQ and you pick a ESCO, which is an energy services company, to work with, we do the procurement process. So we go to lowest qualified bid. Lowest qualified bid means we vet out our contractors. We don't do lowest bid because we guarantee the work. So we have to make sure whoever we work with on these measures is someone who's going to be in business for throughout the life cycle across the project. So we do all that for you. And then we also have our own financing, which means we can go internally to Siemens Financial and they can be competitive when it comes to the rate that you get in the performance contract, or we can go through your bank where you use. There's options. You're not tied to Siemens Financial by any means, but they just have a competitive rate when it comes to the interest rate that you're looking for because they're doing the project with Siemens. So it's just a benefit to the customer that we're working with. This is essentially how it's set up, is it goes Winthrop Schools and then the ESCO, whoever it is that you choose to do an ESCO with, which is after that RFQ process, you put out an RFQ, ESCOs respond, you interview and you select an ESCO to work with. Then the ESCO is responsible for everything that has to do with the project. You develop, design, construction, finance, and then we maintain it throughout the measurement and verification process, which is the guarantee. We guarantee, even if you stop the energy savings guarantee after, say, year three, because you made your energy savings, it works out, you can stop your M&D, we still guarantee the performance of that work throughout the financing term of the project. So we're with you as a partner throughout that, the entire financing term.
Eric, can I ask, do you want questions at the end or as we go through?
What?
Do you want questions now or as...
We can do questions as we go. That's fine.
All I want to say is what you just said, that's an important piece to me. That's true whoever the ESCO is, right?
Yes, whoever the ESCO is. This is a standardized process. This isn't just a Siemens process. Whoever the ESCO is should be responsible. Siemens has their own benefits too, but that's why you do the RFQ process and then interview your ESCOs. The process that we do is our first step is we address why you're looking to do a performance contract. What are your objectives? What are your challenges? And then what are the drivers that you're looking for? Because we are your service provider, we do have some knowledge that it's aging infrastructure, it's equipment that is at its end of life or has obsolete parts, so it's no longer in service and you can't get parts to fix it. Finances, every school district has that problem of funding. And right now, air quality improvements, getting your buildings up to proper ventilation standards so that you meet ASHRAE 62.1, which during this pandemic life is fairly important. So those are all the current needs that the school district has, and those are something that we would have as the baseline of our project. This breaks down a little bit how we would look at it is, this is typically how a school building is broken out as far as your energy usage and then where your, what we call essentially low-hanging fruit, so where we would find your savings. Lighting, LED lighting, that is very important this day and age because 2022 is going to be one of the last years of the high rebate incentive programs. In New Hampshire, for example, starting in 2023, they're going to start reducing it by 25%. Efficiency Main isn't far behind that for LED lighting because they look at it like you should be doing it. LED lighting nowadays is common. You should. So after fiscal year 2023, with so for Efficiency Main is in June, it potentially could start going down. So we would capitalize on lighting. We would do indoor air quality, which would be ventilation improvements, unit ventilator replacements for older unit ventilators. Obviously, boilers are huge usage of energy, especially if they're older and reach the end of their life. Automation. So this is just a breakdown of how we look at a building. An example of a project and how it's financed. This is the basic way we would estimate your project size through energy. You would use your total utility spend. Savings, roughly, safely, we can say we're going to meet around 15 to 25% of your savings. That over the term of the project, depending on the finance rate, how you're going to take the size of the project that you're going to reach. We typically look closer to a 17-year term. That's where the sweet spot is with banks as far as interest rates. So it's going to be somewhere between 15 and 20 years that I think you'll get the best interest rate. Those are the past 10 years. That's pretty much where we landed. Now for the buildings, we've been working on buildings. We've seen the buildings. Every building, we will look at lighting upgrades, building envelope improvement, kitchen efficiency improvement. But each school right now has some pretty strong measures that need improvement. For example, at the middle school, the boilers that are in there right now are sized for residential. We would want to evaluate that and address it to make sure that we eliminate any problems down the road because it is a school facility. So we would evaluate the current boilers that are currently undersized because they're residential boilers. We'd also replace pneumatic controls and all the equipment that is associated with those. There's currently classroom equipment that is on pneumatics that we would want to replace and update because they're old and they're obsolete. And then we were just talking about repair for life hallways that you guys are looking at as well. The high school, same thing. We look at all the low hanging fruit. And then the boiler in the high school, they actually discontinued that 5 years ago. So we're going to have some hard time getting parts. So we would propose replacing it with condensing boilers, which Viessmann, who is our partner, we have a national agreement with Viessmann. So we get certain buying power with them, which brings the cost of the boilers cheaper. They just came out with a brand new boiler that can get, it's smaller, so you can get more usage out of it, you get higher efficiency, and they've so far performed better than we've seen condensing boilers, so we would evaluate the option of using a decent condensing boiler.
Gary?
Yep.
Is it also true that at the high school there is currently one boiler?
Yes, one large field boiler.
Yeah, and?
We would look for redundancy.
Look for?
So when we would replace it, we would probably put into condensing boilers so that you would have redundancy. It would be sized to meet the building.
Right.
But if one failed, you would have a backup. And then we would also improve the domestic hot water. So it would not be on the boilers. The domestic hot water would be a separate, more efficient system so that in the summer, you're not running the boilers for the
small use of hot water, you would be running just a smaller domestic hot water system. Right now, the domestic hot water is off of that one boiler. So you're operating a larger, very small, very low efficient boiler all year round just for some hot water. You're going to capitalize on a lot of savings by replacing that. Same with the grade school. We would look here at addressing the boiler room improvements, and again, Mills boiler, they're discontinued, so we would do condensing boilers, and then also figure out what's the most optimal boiler room layout for this school. Currently, there's two. Should we make one boiler room or keep the two, replace the boilers? That's something we, our engineers would evaluate. And we would also improve the ventilation, since a lot of this building does not have proper ventilation and it's not up to the code requirements. So anytime we touch a school building when it comes to ventilation, we have to bring it up to ASHRAE 62.1, which is your standard ventilation. And then our process is kind of, like I said, it's a holistic approach. We start with the bird's eye view, your current state of where the buildings are at. Then we get into a detailed energy audit, which typically is 3 months of our time. We have engineers, we have contractors, and they go through and do a detailed audit of your buildings. And then it would be implementation. And on the other side of that, we would be working on a capital plan. So we would be looking at long-term goals, long-term facility usage, and how best to lay out your capital planning projects for a 0 to 5 year, 5 to 10, and then also capitalizing on energy savings. This is an example of how we do that. We would have this type of table for every single building. It would show high school, grade school, middle school, and it would be broken out by savings, costs, rebates, and then priorities. So immediate need, middle of the road need, and then we could wait on this. And as you take, you can see the ones and the zeros in the in and out column. As you take these in and out of the spreadsheet, it all wraps up into a cash flow that then will show you your project cost, how it affects the financing rate, what your overall cash flow will look like as you add in and out. So this is how we come up with a phased planning approach to the projects. And we'll break it out by here's energy savings, here's capital improvement measures, here's wish list items, as you can see. Life expectancy, for example, if you have any AC units with R22, that is going to be getting, that is already getting phased out by the EPA, so we would break the column for you have to replace this. And that way, this tool is also helpful for you to capital plan down the road. Now it all ties into the new bipartisan infrastructure bill, which as it's getting rolled out, we've been staying on top of it. There's a lot of aspects to this bill that can be very beneficial to schools. There's three categories that schools are going to be eligible for. Energy efficiency, which is the first one, $500 million. It's a grant program. So that is something that we can, as it gets rolled out, we'll see what measures could we apply for the grant, which the grant from the state is going to be completely funded, or they'll give you a portion of it. Then they amended the performance contracting law so that we can now use block grant money and federal money to help buy down and pay for a performance contract. Typically, if there was federal money, like the ESSER money or revolving renovation funds, you couldn't use those towards performance contracts. This now amended that law, so you can. That's beneficial because this money's not going to be rolled out like ESSER. Each district's not going to get a certain amount. You're going to have to apply for it, and it's going to be starting in fiscal year 2022, which is now, and it's going to be application driven. The last is the revolving renovation loan fund. That probably will roll out this summer if it's like typical revolving renovation funds. And it will be another application process. It's the reduced lunch ratio that you get relieved.
Yep.
The revolving renovation fund that you talked about, there was the federal revolving renovation fund, not the state one?
Right, there's going to be, this looks like it's going to be new. They have not rolled out much information as far as how the application process is going to go, how long it's going to go. I think based on my research and talking with Siemens, it's going to be after February 18th, because until February 18th, the federal government is still working under the 2020 budget. So after February 18th, this now will come into effect. And since it's starting in fiscal year 2022, I'm looking at end of February, early March, that I would assume we can start finding information on the applications, how it's going to get rolled out, how we can apply for it. And at that point, it would be, what do we have that's shovel ready to submit for an application? We've done a million revolving renovation fund applications. Prior to me taking over this role, I was an energy engineer on this team, and I did them all, so I'm very familiar with the revolving renovation fund application. So we would want to have as much of an application backing to then submit to them to show and look at this.
So you would submit the applications for these? We wouldn't do that?
We would submit them with you on your behalf, just like we've done with the revolving renovation funds. We can't technically submit it as Siemens, so we would essentially fill out as much of the application as we can, and then you would submit it. But most of them come with a lot of technical information and questions that we would then do. So as these come out, we're staying on top of it, and we would figure out the best way to apply for it. For example, in this, you can see there's one of the sections is weatherization assistant program. So if there is building envelope, window improvements, insulation additions, we might be able to apply for a separate application on top of the Florence contract for those measures. And we would look at how the best way to lay out those projects are. There's also a section in there for buses. That's not something Siemens does, obviously, but we would, as a partner, help you apply for some of those programs. There's two school bus programs that would, one of the programs would pay for 100% of the zero or low emission buses, if you need to do buses, and infrastructure improvement to support those buses. There's a lot of different categories underneath this new infrastructure bill, and it's just on our end, we would stay on top of it and see how it's rolled out and what the best way to help you use that money is. Same with the walk grant programs now that it's being able to use under loan programs. And in addition to that, we've already done a project here for bipolar ionization. We would continue to look at different ways to help mitigate airborne particles. Siemens, there's nothing anybody can do right now to fully, erase COVID or raise any viruses in the air, but our goal is any technologies that we have that can help make it a safer environment for students and staff to return to, we would at least provide the option, whether it's the needlepoint bipolar ionization or our lighted, which is a light sensor that goes into the lights, and it has the capabilities to do contact tracing and heat sensors, so you can, if there's a specific area that you knew there was a COVID outbreak in, you would see it through the IoT platform. So we would evaluate that and at least provide the option of, here's something that you can do. So we take now additional measures into consideration with the new world we live in. Then this goes into the workforce development that we do. This is something we always, it's different for every single district. It's based on what your current STEM platform is, what your workforce development programs are, and we always include students in our projects. One of the things that I always did as an energy engineer was bring students around with us while we did our audits, because it introduces them to a whole different side of engineering, in STEM industry, what Siemens does, and now in this position, what I started is a new internship program. So throughout our project, if there's a junior or senior class of students that is interested, they can become part of our project team and they can follow along with us throughout development. We would have them come and present some of the measures to the school board because it is really important for students to get the confidence and public speaking ability. So we would have them join us as part of our project team. And at the end, we would then give them a scholarship for college and part of the Siemens internship with a recommendation, and they can officially say they were part of the Siemens internship program. So there's a lot of different avenues that we do to help support the STEM side, the workforce development programs that your district has, and any student interest in engineering. As you can see, some of it is in the classroom activities. It's simply the district has a need for a STEM lab, and we've provided a few grant, 20 and 30 different districts to help them build a STEM lab or go towards their teachers who have those programs. So it, like I said, it varies based on the district, your need, and their interests. So that's kind of that's the overview of what the performance contract is, our process, how it would look for your schools based on our experience and relationship with Winthrop on the service side and what we know. So if there's any follow-up questions, I know that was a massive data dump, but I can also provide this PowerPoint to you guys.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Can you just kind of quickly go through the next steps again?
Yep, so the next steps would be an RFQ process. So you would put out an RFQ into the local paper as well as the Canada Journal for it's 5 to 7 days that it would stay in there. ESCOs, an energy services company, like Siemens, we would respond to your RFQ. Then you would select, I think there's four companies say that responded. All you have to do, you have to select a minimum of three if there's more than that, and interview them. So we would interview with your interview committee. And then from there, you would then select the ESCO you want to partner with. You would sign what we call a letter of intent that basically says we're gonna partner with you to develop this project. If you decide not to do a project, then there is a buyout of typically price per square foot. It's just for the engineering cost. You get to keep all of the information. So that spreadsheet that I showed you with capital planning, for our sake, that is what you get to keep. If you sign up to a project. So that would be your next step process.
And you will assist us in developing the RFQ?
Yes. Yep, I can send you over an RFQ. That would be, it's a very blanket. It has nothing to do with Siemens. It's very neutral. And it would be for any ESCO. So it's a standard RFQ proposal that you would put out. And then every ESCO, again, that's part of why you interview and get the RFQ responses, is every ESCO has a little bit of a different process. And this is how we do our process. Our deliverable is that spreadsheet, but part of your work is just to see what process works for your district. So, and how you want it to get rolled out.
How long does the RFQ process typically take?
So the RFQ process, between putting the RFQ out and selecting a ESCO, is typically about a month and a half, a month, depending on how fast you want to move, because you have to leave it in the paper for 2 weeks. Mm-hmm. Then you get the responses, and I mean, if you want to hold interviews the next day, you can hold them all on the same day.
Okay.
Some districts do, but typically it's about a month just because of the work.
Okay.
Thank you. About, and then it would be, at this point, you'd probably be looking to a lot, some of the work would be planned for summer 23 because it would be done during off hours of school. However, some of it would be due during nights, holidays, etc. So,
okay.
But the RFP process is on.
Alright. During the interview portion, is that where we just ask questions about the process, or do we also ask questions about the company as a whole?
Both.
Okay.
It would be, however, whatever you want to know about who you want to be your partner, because these projects do, like I said, are 15, 17 years. You want to partner ideally with somebody who not only knows your building, has a service that is ongoing to help maintain the new equipment that comes in. And it's a partnership, it's a relationship. So you can ask, you should ask both questions. You should get, you know, personal information about the company and then also what your backing is, what their finances are. It's a partnership, so.
Thank you.
And I can even send you some examples of questions that some boards have asked and asked and what gives them, you know, the best information. And in this case, I would also just urge you to keep in mind the dates of the federal money that's coming out. It does start in fiscal year 22, and since it's not like ESSER, it is going to be application driven. So you'll want the most information into that and the best shot that you can to get some of that money.
So it would be a quick turnaround, if I'm understanding it correctly, once you select your ESSER person, you have to almost immediately start applying for some of the infrastructure bills?
Yes, I mean, I'm hoping end of February, early March, we will have at least an idea of these applications because, I mean, they're coming down in fiscal year 22 pretty quick.
Yeah.
And from our experience with granting and federal funding, the application processes are typically a month to a month and a half. So they don't give districts, unfortunately, which is crazy, enough time to, if you're starting from zero.
Right.
Which in this case, it is good that we do have some knowledge of the schools, but any company can do, you know, we can come in and do the backing, but yeah, it's typically, unfortunately, for some of the applications.
All right, thank you.
Sure, let's take 10 minutes. Yeah, if there's any questions, you can have my email.
Eric, so. You want to add anything?
I think you covered everything.
Sorry, I know there's a lot of information. It was almost like a watering hose.
Okay. Yeah,
you
would
great.
Send that on to Jen if you can share it with us,
PowerPoint. RFQ and then additional questions that some districts ask.
Thank you for that.
Yeah. Thank you guys for having us.
Tim, do you have any questions?
Yeah. No, thank you.
Okay. Next up is the updated maintenance list, which I think starts on page 48 of that packet, right? Or is that part of Siemens?
Nope, that's on. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you guys.
Thank
Have
you.
A good night. Thank
awesome.
You.
Oh. So you need to get there you go. You need to get up here closer to the
computer. Okay. So just to follow up on this presentation and how all that works. So I've been working with these guys since July. Found myself here. I've been working with these folks since July. My sense in working with them is that we've been very informative because they already have our contracts. But basically where we are at is what they're talking about. So the first time I presented to you, Kelly, I'll never forget, you got the point. You were saying to me, basically, thank you for basically rocking this whole world mind that I thought was security with our buildings because it doesn't exist. What they're talking about is trying to get us back to that position. We are a very small contract compared to what they do, so I feel very comfortable working with them.
I just want, I think the PowerPoint she just did is what was already sent to you.
Okay.
I was just following along.
Yeah.
So.
Okay.
So basically, I just wanted to let you know that a lot of information that you just had shared with you, I've been working with for a couple months with these folks, via email, really getting caught up in what we have for systems. In the budget, which you probably haven't seen yet, my budget that I'm operating on this year is at $1.3 million, which includes everything, personnel and so forth. Keeping everything the same and adding what needs to happen, a lot of what she was just talking about puts up to 2.7. So that's a major increase. What I'm going to share with you is this list here. All of these items you're about to read about are not in the budget, but these are coming. This is just the grade school. Because it's so large, I didn't want to overwhelm you with three different schools. As you go up, the grade level is no surprise because it's in a high school building.
the list does go down. But these are just some things that, at the bottom of my budget draft that I gave to Jim, was already in place when you were asking for the list last time. That was already on my budget. And again, please remember that these items are not budgeted for, but these items also come from, I'm just gonna give this to Jolene because it affects her directly. If anybody else wants one.
Okay, you guys already, this is already in this packet.
This is?
Yep.
Okay, great, awesome. So as you go through some of these things though, however, I just wanna let you know that these were identified by an architectural group from the study that you did 3 years ago. Every one of these items on here, at this time as we stand here, are at the end of their life. Meaning, if you were to look through that, you'd be like, Joel, this says 3 years, that's where we are right now. So again, as you look through some of these things, these are not things like a wish list. These are things that have to happen. These are like cracked foundations. For example, yesterday I dealt with a spill in the central office because the foundation is cracked on the outside and there's literally a stream that comes in when it rains. You know, is it a big deal? Not right now, but when that water freezes and it starts to crack over time, that will expand and you have a foundation issue. There's a foundation issue on the other side of this wall, right here, where this beam comes down on. That's a safety issue. Your gym, those were simple 2x8 construction back in the 50s because that was okay. They're made out of wood. That's a long time ago. Do a quick math, it's 70 years ago. Those are depreciated at the end of their life. On the north corner over here, you have another cracked foundation. You can clearly see it if you want to see it when you're back. Just look up to the corner back over here by Sioux Special Ed Wing, and you'll see the crack coming down right through not only the wall and the brick, but also the cement slab that it's resting on. ADA, we're okay because, like they said, the second you touch it, you have to address it. But there's some issues in the grade schools, specifically near the CD going down through. That's gonna be I have a bid on that already just because I started looking into that for the renovation fund. It's so astronomical, it would have wiped out everything else we were gonna do in the grade school because you're going in behind the surface that there's no record of what's behind it, number one. And number two, you're talking about taking out half the stair system and rebuilding it, but also putting in a new lift. So there's nothing there to use, basically. I could go through this whole list.
Can you just clarify that? Because I think it's important, so I was asked this question before. There's nothing wrong with the lift, but if we redo the stairs, it won't fit on that.
Correct. And other things. Not only will it not fit, but it's not an adequate lift. Right. You can get by with it, but it's not what's safe. It's not morally safe, right? This is the best way to put that. So again, you know, we could go through every single one of these and we can certainly have an evening and I can tell you about all of the issues here. We do have information that backs all of the claims. Again, this isn't just some sort of kick to justify what I did. This is real stuff that's been going for a long period of time. What does that all mean for you? Well, as Jim has said to you, and I'll restate to you, we have a couple options that we can look at. My suggestion to you is as much as people may or may not want to do it, I would swallow the whole thing at one time, and I would do all of these and bring everything up to date. And there's three different avenues that we can look at. We can look at bond, we can look at what we were just talking about with Siemens, and we can look at renovation funds. Problem with renovation fund, some of those things you'll see in my budget are in the renovation fund. We have timeline constraints, we have funding constraints, and there's no guarantee that you'll get all of those things. Bond, that's something that has to go to the town. I think you're going to be fighting a big battle there. I don't know that for sure, but it's certainly something, Jim can talk more about that because I know that he's talked to the town about that. To me, I guess what I'm not doing a good job getting to again is that what Siemens just presented to you is our best option. We can pay it over time. You also have a guarantee where if the energy is not safe, you get that money back from them or they come in and they fix it. What does that mean to me? That means that I'm not gonna be on the phone all the time getting things fixed because they're gonna put it in right. When she talked about contractors not taking the lowest bid, they're gonna take the best people because they're gonna lose money if it's not done right. So they're gonna do all of that work that quite frankly, I don't know how to do because this isn't my world.
I'll make sure your building's up and running, and I will call people to fix those things. But if we get into a big project like that, this is the route to go. If I could put it in terms of another project I'm working on right now, the number one thing I need to do to get the turf going is hire an engineer that is going to be a foreman to make sure that all of the other things happen. Because you can sit down and tell me that it's good, and I'm going to go come back and tell you that everything's great, because that's what I'm being told, and I don't know the difference. That's what these folks do to your buildings. Yes?
This list right here that you just gave us.
Yes.
Is this covered under that performance contract or not covered under?
Most of the items would be, yes.
It would be?
Yes.
Okay.
Yep.
I'm not sure. I can't hear very well. It's okay.
It's okay.
You were talking about your budget.
Yes.
Going from 1.3 to
2.7.
What do you mean by that 1.4 million? Is that this?
So 1.4 is what we're operating on right now for this year.
Okay.
I'll need that next year, and I will need double that basically to get.
For this?
No.
Or other stuff?
For other stuff that's in the budget.
So you need that plus the performance contract? I'm just trying to get it.
If we decide to go with the performance contract, I don't need that.
Okay.
Yep.
That's what I want to get at.
Exactly.
Okay. So that's total.
Yeah, let me jump in here, because we, last two or three meetings, I've talked about a multi-pronged approach, and that's what Joel was talking about. So we have a lot of balls in the air with respect to how to get some of this work done. Now, revolving renovation is one. What Carrie shared tonight about this new federal program is another. Performance contract gets tied in. I'm still a little fuzzy about exactly what is part of a performance contract and what can be covered under federal funds if we're able to secure those. As Joel mentioned, I continue to have conversations with the town manager about a potential bond. The problem with that is that's I don't think we can get all that at once, which would be ideal, but I don't think we can. But a potential bond with the town is probably at least 2 years away. But very real, a very real possibility. And then we are also looking at what we have for undesignated balance, fund balance. It's not going to cover a lot.
I'm just trying to kind of wrap my brain around a total number. So to get us to where we need to be.
Yes.
In whatever time frame, you're thinking about 1.3, 1.4 million.
To get us so that we can operate next year and do some things that have to be done, I need $2.7 million. Not me personally,
right,
that would be pretty nice.
But
we need a $2.7 million budget next year for maintenance.
Okay, thank
you. If we decide to go the route of a performance contract, that 2.7 drastically gets dropped.
Okay.
It'll take care of most of those things.
Okay.
What you should know, though, to answer your other question, I think you were getting at, is I can't tell you how much this is because I don't know.
Right.
No one has even looked at this stuff since we've been made aware of it.
But the other thing that's on this list, the last thing on the list here, there are some things on here that aren't covered under performance contract.
That's what I'm trying to.
Carrie mentioned that.
Yes, yes.
Paving issues, for
instance. There are some things, but not all of them.
Okay.
Yes.
He has $500,000 worth of paving that probably is a low number, probably higher than that. We have significant paving issues at grade school and at middle school, and we're trying to secure ways to find that fund, you know, find ways to fund that.
Yep.
And I was thinking when I talked to another vendor that they might be able, we might be suggesting that funding in the federal legislation.
Yeah, which just came about since we've been working on this for the last 6 months.
Yeah.
I can tell you, and this might help you, and I'm sorry, I forgot to tell you this, my brain gets going so quick. If there's a number next to it, I have a bid. So for like a paving, $500,000, that just addresses what needs to be done.
Yeah.
Like the grade school, we all know, is a mess.
Yeah.
In front of the nurse's office is a mess. Mm-hmm. In front of the school, at the grade school, is a mess.
Yeah. Oh, that is a total mess.
But the things that are in the budget with the price tag, Kelly, you alluded to this last meeting, those are the things I've identified that are critical.
Okay.
And those have a price tag because I have that price tag from a quote.
Yep. I was just
going to
ask you something else, and I don't know what it was. I think it will happen.
Yep.
So, I know what it was. I noticed you wrote the cleaning employees and equipment.
Yes.
Is it your opinion that that would be a money saver if we brought it back in-house, or do you think it's going to kind of wash?
I think it's going to be a money saver for two reasons. Number one, I think you're going to get a better finished product.
Yeah.
And number two, we already paid for the janitorial supplies.
Right.
So they show up and use their equipment. It's all that we're gaining out of that. On a personal opinion, I think that not only is it a better product, but we have some pride and we have more control over that.
Yeah.
That would be a hard sell, I think, to people right now because of it's hard to get people in here.
Yeah.
But at the same time, I know that would really work for us.
Okay.
The other piece is, at any point, if they get tired of me giving them a hard time, they can walk.
Right.
Within 30 days, and we have nothing anyways.
Okay.
Jim and I have talked about this at length. There's other things we can do besides just using these folks to show up and clean buildings. There's things that we can do, such as, bus driving, maintenance. There's all kinds of things that we can plug these folks into.
Okay.
I think, and a little bit off topic here, but I think it's something, and I wish everybody was here to hear this, but there are some decisions that have been made in the past few years that I think are, I don't know that I would have supported them if I were sitting in the seat. Selling our buses was a horrible idea. I'm intrigued by the possibility of and having a conversation. Northeast Charters is a great company. This is zero to do with them.
Absolutely.
They would be interested to see if we could start to purchase our own buses and go back to the lease agreement or the agreement with them to have them continue to be Winthrop buses and Northeast Charters essentially use them. That type of system has been involved in Winthrop it has been working here way before Northeast Charter. I mean, I always say that I remember when I was in high school, and it was years ago, Baker Bus Service ran the buses up here, and as far as I know, Winthrop's always had contracted busing of some form. And that's one thing, because a year from now, we're going to get beat up bad in the budget because of that deal. Secondly, FMS, contracting, Joel and I have talked about this many times. I'm so in favor of us finding a way to bring our own custodians back. There's just the pride in the work. And again, I have to emphasize that people who are doing this work are really good people, especially the people who work around here. This is, but I would prefer them to be our people. Because what I said before about we need more work, we need more help in grade school. If they were our people, we'd just make that change.
Right.
Now we can't do that, and that's very frustrating. Well, I'm sorry, we could make that change, but at a significant cost. The issue that's, as we costed this out before, is really about the other decision that was made that's frustrating to me, is when we contracted with FMS, I don't even know when that was, I'm not pointing fingers at anybody, is we sold them all our equipment. So we buy all the supplies, but we don't have any floor machines, we don't have anything. So conservatively, it would cost us probably $200,000 to get that equipment back for all of our buildings. And Joel is right, we probably could save some money, but even if we didn't save any money, but we get better service, I think it's better in the long run.
Yep.
How many people would you anticipate that we would have to hire?
I would probably say that we would be three in grade school, two in middle school,
three
in high school.
Three, two,
and
three?
Yeah, so seven. Yeah.
I only got one working.
No,
here.
I got it.
I have that. I actually have it written down in my office. We went through that. I didn't know it was going to come up our budget, those numbers. But it's
close.
No,
that's
it's
okay. I was just
enough.
Wondering. Thinking about the future?
Yeah, absolutely.
So, in reading this list, it looks like essentially, there are no sprinklers in any of the classroom units?
No.
Okay. And is that because the building's grandfathered?
It's grandfathered now, yes, but the second we start doing things again, you have to address
it. It's not good.
No, absolutely not. Again, for me, I look at this from a moral lens. I think it's really important that we address that. It's a safety issue.
Yeah. I agree.
But I think, I don't know the whole history of it, but I know that there was a time that they were looking at it, and I'm not sure exactly what happened there. Mm-hmm. I know there was some bad luck between
I will tell you though that we're starting to evolve out that we're gonna have to look at replacing some sprinkler heads. This year we got about $16,000 to work at the high school because the pipes are failing.
But that type of thing, maybe not that specific example, that type of thing, given the age of our middle school and our high school, you said it's still fairly new, but that's a perfect, it's a prime age to take a look at what the efficiencies are and what we can do. We have a better chance of savings at the middle school and high school doing all the projects that Carrie listed here. Again, whether Siemens does it or some other ESCO does it. The stuff at the grade school is I can tell you the district where I did a performance contract for the two oldest buildings, including one that I'm sure Kelly had attended many years, not just a few years ago. Anyway, that they wouldn't even assess the building because there was no return on it. They couldn't guarantee that. Why they're looking at the grade school and why we're looking at all these different creative ways of funding is the need exists. And it may not fit under a performance contract because you can't realize the efficiency. The cost is too great to recover. But they'd help looking at other ways to, they know what our needs are, and they're gonna help us find ways to fund that.
Yeah.
Okay.
And the lighting, is huge to look at for what she was talking about, but I can tell you that because of the CMP increases, our district-wide bill went up $100,000 because it went up 82%. And that is right from the horse's mouth. I contacted folks there because I was thinking maybe that the school would be right.
So,
Jim, do you have any questions?
This is just a list for the grade school. Do you also have a list for the middle and high school that you can share?
Yep.
At some point? Okay.
Yep.
And if we enter into a performance contract, that would be district-wide, not just for the grade school.
Correct.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's what I was going to ask. If they find that we can realize some savings at the middle school and high school, but not the grade school, would they just guarantee those, or does it have to be district wide?
Yeah, they would come back to you and say we can't do the grade school because we can't guarantee the work. So,
but for the other two schools?
Yes.
Okay.
I can tell you that actually, believe it or not, the high school, the newest building, is the highest rate of burning of oil.
Oh, I know. I've done the warrants.
Yes. Yeah.
It's amazing.
It's because of that ridiculous one. It goes right up there.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Okay.
And again, just contact me if you want to sit down sometime and we can go through these things. The book that I gave to Carrie earlier is an architectural study, and that's where I got all the information. Again, that's all backed by people coming in here and doing a lot of what they just talked about.
Yeah.
That's the first time she's seen it, so that's going to even fast track things sooner if you decide to go this route, which I would highly recommend.
Okay. Thank you, Joel. Thank
you
for gathering all of this.
Oh, yeah, no problem.
All right. Cool business.
I think that we need to put on our next agenda that we'll talk about the winter sports, school testing versus vaccination.
Why don't we talk about it now?
Well, because I think we can talk about it now, but I think we need to potentially take a different vote. Because the vote that we took on November 17th says that everybody will pool test and vaccination is optional. And now that we've made the change to make masking completely required, no matter what activity somebody is doing, whether they're actively participating or not, we may be able to revisit whether pool testing remains a requirement for all members or not.
I agree with you.
I'm sorry, I'm not seeing it, but it doesn't matter how much it switches. I don't even know what to put on the question. Joel is slow, but that's what we've been doing.
And that's what we were, that's why Joel was asking the question about needing to get the people who are vaccinated, because we're not requiring people who are vaccinated to pool test. I know it was written, and you're correct about that, and I played my superintendent's report, and we should clarify that, but if we wait another 2 weeks to clarify, our winter sports season will pretty much be done. So if you want to say, I think it's simple to say, if you expect us to pool test everybody, regardless of the vaccination status, you can say that. We'll do it.
Well, that is what we said in November, that we expected everybody to be pool test regardless of their vaccination status.
I know that's what was written. I don't think that was what was intended.
That's what I intended when I said it.
But is it a moot point, though, if we're saying, that was all hinged on the fact that the active participants would not have to mask. That has now changed. So do we need to just drop the pool testing requirement one way or the other? Because they have to be masked for us to be considered a universal masking school. That was why we did that, was for the people who could be on the floor unmasked.
I don't feel like I'm balking at it. I don't care. I just need to know so we can enforce that. I can tell you that we have been doing the pool test or be vaccinated, not with every single person asking a pool testing.
Right.
But furthermore,
that's a good point that we can decide we're not even going to require a pool testing in general.
But I was going to say. And so Emily Poland, when asked a similar question in our Zoom, asked why would anybody continue to pool test under these circumstances? I think I shared this with you before. It's about layers of protection.
Right.
Pool testing gives us quicker access to our, Joel, you may want to stay up front because some of the stuff that you want to be involved with. All the layers that we do, and we strip away so many layers, particularly the close contact stuff, which I understand. And the information, it's amazing how I feel like I'm always about a week or two behind the CDC. I was not comfortable with their decision initially. I'm far more comfortable with it now. That's irrelevant. So the question about pool testing, when asked, she responded that it really was just another layer of protection. It's a way to identify as quickly as possible when there's an outbreak. I can tell you that subsequently, they are now saying that the Omicron is so fast moving that that's why they're going to, later on when ask you to vote on postpone or doing away with contact tracing, the close contact, because they said it's really become a huge waste of our resources. And I can tell you that I've heard specifically from Nurse Melissa, but Jeannie has been very clear that it makes no sense given where things are with Omicron.
Right.
But Omicron's different than Delta, though it's different than the original, so it's all over the map. So that's what I'm saying. I wasn't trying to be difficult or whatever. I'm just saying if you wanted to, what you're saying is that we now want to say, well, actually, thought that the vote was everybody had in sports who were extra. Curriculum had to be in pool testing, and if they're vaccinated, that's great. And whether the vaccination status was irrelevant. Now, what Sue is suggesting, and the most recent stuff I'm hearing is why do pool testing at all, or at least why require our athletes? Why require? That's probably a better way to say it.
Require not just athletes, but anybody in
our co-curricular extracurricular.
Who before did not have to mask.
But now they all have to mask, so.
They do have to mask.
Yeah.
Yes.
So the issue came up that we were contacted by a parent who had some questions about the way things were handled, specifically for sports. And I had responded saying, well, they either need to pool test or they need to vaccinate. But then the parent brought back the November 17th.
Is that what you shared with me?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Notes. And so I went and found my actual handwritten notes from that meeting to see if maybe there was a typo or not. But what I had written was that pool testing would be mandatory for all athletes and vaccination would be recommended.
Okay.
So the question is now, if all participants, regardless of what they're doing, are required to be masked, should we still continue to require pool testing for all participants or have it there as an optional thing?
I feel it should be optional. And we feel like we should require it. If they have to wear the mask, that was the whole reason why we did that.
Only for athletics and co-training.
Right.
We're not doing away with pool testing at all.
No, I just don't think it should be required.
So I guess my question is, would it be required for participants who were not vaccinated?
Why are they masked?
Well, they are masked, but stuff can still get through the mask. And
but
as I said,
people who are vaccinated can still catch COVID, they can still give COVID, so I don't know why you would make that mistake.
But these kids, specifically the athletes, aren't just sitting. They're running. They're breathing very hard in each other's faces.
Well,
which was
they don't
my
have
concern
masks
here.
On.
That doesn't protect everybody from everything.
Right, but my point is, the people who are vaccinated, who are running hard, can still have COVID and spread it. So why would you designate between somebody that's vaccinated and unvaccinated?
Because the people who are vaccinated, science has proven, have less issues than people who don't vaccinate.
But they still spread it.
So we don't care about what happens to the person who gets it, we just care about what happens to the person who's spreading it, is what I mean.
No, what I mean is, if we're talking about slowing the spread, right? That's what the point, and catching people who are have COVID, right? That's what the pool testing is for. So, well, what if it's the people who have the vaccination or the ones who are actually positive and not an unvaccinated person, but you're not going to catch it because the person who's vaccinated doesn't have to be pool tested.
I guess from my perspective, I have the numbers that I brought, and I didn't make copies for everybody, but if you look at the numbers that are posted weekly on the website, actually, a question for Mr. Campbell and for actually Mr. Stoneson. But first week that we were back, we had 24 high school students test positive for COVID, and 4 at the middle school. This week that ended last Friday, we had 15 at the middle school and 12 more at the high school. So it's 36 total over 2 weeks at the high school, 19 at the middle school. How many of those? Not an exact number, I'm not going to really remember. How many of those were people involved in athletics? Hockey, basketball, what percentage would you say?
Say quite high. I'd say close to somewhere around between 60 and 75%.
So we've made the change to require everybody to wear a mask. It's already happened. And my question is this, it goes back to what I was saying before about Emily Poland's statement about we do pool testing because that's another layer of protection. If we know that those people who are on the floor, on whatever, or on stage, as Caroline was, they are, they're interacting in a different way. If we don't require them, then we don't catch them at any point. We don't catch them quicker, so I don't know what the downside of being in pool testing is.
I don't know.
Caroline.
Oh, I was just about to say that there was a huge spread on the Miranda Good ski team, which came over to winter.
On which
team? Miranda.
Miranda. The spread for winter.
And we have kids that ski from Miranda, right?
Yes. Yeah. Okay.
So I guess my point is, the numbers, and I know talking to Ms. Campbell a lot and Mr. Stoneson, that it's hard. I mean, it's not a pure, certainly not even a scientific study that we were looking at. We had break. There was no pool testing. We came out of that with no pool, without having any pool testing, and we have this huge increase in number of athletes who are testing positive.
again, we made the change to wear a mask, so we expect that to slow down. You know, the Omicron is somewhat subsiding nationally, not here in Maine, but so that gives us hope. We have approximately 6 weeks left to our winter sports. That's why I want to make the decision tonight. I don't want to wait 2 more weeks. And like I said, there are some things that make sense to me, some things that don't. It doesn't make sense to require everybody to be pool testing, but that seems simple to me. If I were looking at how many kids are in pool testing and are vaccinated?
I don't know.
A lot, or?
Do you still not have the number?
I have a quick question.
I don't care if you give me a number.
How many of these athletes are going to be in that 90-day window?
Quite a few.
Anyway.
I think what I'm hearing that you're probably referring to, and I think it's a fair question to ask, is if we mask up to be part of a mandated school,
right,
why are athletes being pointed out,
right,
and have to pool test?
Or anybody.
We're not asking students to do it.
Doctors, whoever. Yep.
We're not asking students to do it. Now, I can tell you that there's been many conversations that with athletics, the mask comes down quicker because they are running around. And that's my issue that I'm trying to deal with, and not yours. However, if we are doing it because it's an extension of the classroom and we're not requiring students to do it, I'm not sure why we're asking athletes to do it as well as co-curricular and signaling those folks out. Yeah. Is it because it's in the public eye? I don't know.
Right.
And I'm not even getting into the science, not to be disrespectful,
right,
to anybody. I'm just,
right,
saying that I think being neutral here and working really hard to keep my opinion out of this, I'm not sure why we're requiring athletes just to test. They're not all students if we're,
right,
talking about the same thing. It is different. You are running around. But in a classroom, you're also sitting next to someone for 15 minutes where you're not on the floor or the ice,
yeah,
or when you're outside school. I mean, there's a counter argument to anything we're going to discuss here. But the reality is that, you know, I hadn't thought about it. Jim said it to me yesterday. It does certainly tag people that have COVID that are around those people, but that's no different than what we're doing at school. I really feel like we've moved towards athletics is being treated differently, but we're saying that we want it the same as school, but that's not how we're treating it. I don't know if that makes sense or not. But
it makes sense. I just don't know that I... Specifically, we haven't talked about this. So
yes.
I disagree. I think the interaction between athletes is significantly different than
yep.
than in school. I think the interaction for, you know, and I don't want to put Caroline sitting here, but I think the interaction with people who are on a stage is significantly different than it is in a classroom. So I think there is a difference, and they choose to be part of their club or their sport or whatever the case may be, and we made that a condition. I guess I personally, and then as I said, we'll do whatever the school committee decides. We need to clarify that. But I do see there's a difference, and I don't know why we wouldn't ask them to continue to do pool testing until Omicron has started to subside, and it hasn't. And Mike, did you say does Dr. McConnell or Jean want to weigh in?
Dr.
McConnell,
you have something to say?
Yeah, I guess I just feel like I just want to weigh in that ultimately your goal is to protect staff and students, correct? And then the second goal is to try to keep kids in school. So it feels like to me when you have kids doing activities that may be a higher risk for spread, which you can see in every newspaper article for the basketball player who's, you know, going up for a jump shot and the mask is coming to the town, et cetera. I think kids that are a lot more active and doing things are going to be a higher risk for spread. I also think that there's a piece, I understand not wanting to take away parental choice. I understand so many parts of this, but I have never once been called and asked to weigh in on a student who is not playing a sport to return to school early for any reason after testing positive. So that, to me, puts sports at a higher risk than mental health of many other students. So if we can do anything to try to slow the spread, to promote kids staying in school, staying healthy mentally, then why would you not do school testing within athletics, drama, one act, et cetera, because those kids are also leaders. And that's who, you know, we want to slow the spread. So I'm just highly, highly pleading with you all to test, to keep masks on, if you really, really want to keep kids in school. Because you know what? Another variant's coming. Sorry to be the bearer of bad news, but Omicron, yeah, it's going to slow down, but another variant's coming. So we might as well figure out how to be strong with, you know, giving people as much choice as possible, but doing the right thing for kids to keep them in school.
I want to add to that because it goes back to what I was saying. We have less than 6 weeks left for the end of the winter sports season, which is indoor. After that, the clubs, which are much easier to sort of manage, when is one act? It's spring, right?
March.
Okay. So, I mean, there's still fewer things inside, and once we get to winter spring sports, we're outside, which is a whole different ballgame. So, Jeannie? No? Joe is now with us.
Is Tim still with us?
Tim is with us.
Okay.
And Joe is with us.
Okay. So I guess the discussion that we need to have is, do we want to change what we decided on November 17th with this mandatory pool testing for all winter after school activities and sports, or do we want to drop pool testing as a requirement? Joe and Tim, do either of you have anything to weigh in?
Sure.
Joe, you muted.
Oh, is Joe speaking or am I speaking?
You are now.
I think we should just stay where we're at right now. That's what I vote for, just keep the pool testing as spread and fast.
Say in the minutes, I'll reiterate that
November 17th, we voted to require a pool testing for all extracurricular, co-curricular activities, and recommend vaccination.
Yes.
Caroline?
Just to make sure that students know that if they recently had COVID, so they can do pool testing, can still participate in the activity?
Absolutely. Yeah, as a matter of fact, I think that's been a recent issue, that we have people who, and I'm sure that nobody did this on purpose, but certainly now we have, and I think this is part of where Sue is coming from, and I understand that, I kind of get that. If theoretically, 100% of our athletes had COVID and are in a 90-day window, it becomes a moot point. But I don't think it's even remotely close to 100% at this point, so. Probably half, so half people would be in a 90-day window, and they have a half of the pool test. So, I will clarify, thank you, Caroline, that's a good clarification.
Just for your knowledge, we do have students that have got it a second time in their window, so.
Yeah.
They've come down with COVID a second time in their 90-day window?
Yes.
Yikes.
That happens. I think we need to be as again, I keep saying Emily Poland, but is Emily Poland something we need to do as much precautionary measures as possible? It's not perfect, and that's been my frustration. It is, you know, like, why don't we just do this or just do that? Well, just anything isn't going to be the answer. Joe raised his hand.
Joe?
Yes.
Yeah.
My question is, I'm assuming that you're talking about after school activities, extracurricular activities, sports events, that type of thing.
Yes.
Now, in sports, we've left it kind of optional, according to the nature of the sports. If the other team has no problems playing without masks, haven't we?
No, not anymore. We changed that in order for us to be considered a universal masking school, which we are, it has to apply to all school-sponsored activities.
So is one act plays?
Yep.
Recommending everybody with a mask?
Correct.
So I'm okay with that.
Universal masking as needed to include after school activities. Information about the extremely high number of positive cases. I'm reading my own notes here. So that we made that change. That was not something I didn't ask the school committee to vote on that because we were clearly caught in a quandary there because it was going to be we're universally masked is what we voted to do. And what we were doing wasn't universally masked, so we made that change effectively. I'm going to pass these out for you guys to see. These are hot off the press this afternoon. I'm going to introduce Mr. Stompton. You guys can have those. We don't need to talk about these, but I've already shared with you the numbers about the high case number of students we've had, and most of them. I'm going to be careful I say this because I think you know me well enough to know I'm a huge supporter of athletics, so. I think it's just circumstantial that the athletes are the ones that are, and it makes sense. When we were not making them wear masks, we were sort of setting ourselves up for an anticipated spike. Omicron is already, that's spiking. We weren't masking. That's helped, cause all these things. We missed 2 weeks of pool testing. 1 week. 2 weeks of pool testing, that created the spike. So, everything that could possibly happen was working against us. So. Why I share those numbers. At the grade school, the week we came back from break, we had 15 students that week and 3 staff members test positive. And I said four students at the middle school and 3 at the middle school staff. 24, let's tell on this, this is a
24 at the high school in that first week back, four staff members. In addition to that, over vacation, there were eight other students for in the grade school that were tested positive. There were five other staff from the grade school that tested positive during the 24th through the 31st, and a sub who tested positive. Get to another thing I need to bring up. This week that ended last Friday, 34 more students tested positive in the grade school. 34. I know there were three pools that were positive today. They did the testing. Four students tested positive out of that. So four more today. Middle school, 15 students, three staff. And high school, this last week, 12 new students, no staff. Thank God. So those numbers are pretty alarming. You want those? They're on the website for anybody who missed that. And by the website, it lists week to week, but you can scroll down, go down the bottom, and you can see whatever week you want to check on. You can bring that those numbers up. What I sent out here, I usually send this out to you via email, but I just got it when I came in at 5 o'clock or 4:30, whatever it was. We have 27 new cases here in Winthrop. Again, that's not specifically students. That's what the CDC keeps track of. In my superintendent's report, I sent the link to this site if you want to go on there and look at it yourself. Keep track. From January 9th to January 16th, there were 27 new cases. That was after we had 38, an all-time record the week before that. So. I don't think 30 to 27 does represent a reduction in numbers, but I'm not sure 27 still is a good number or where we want to get to. You can look for that if you go up my list. There was a time when I missed. December 12th, I missed the December 19th posting, so December 12th to 26th, 2 weeks, we had 31. That's, incredibly not at that. So, I think for us, it feels like we've already loosened the restrictions in terms of close contacts and kids that we quarantined. I think if we can just hold on to the reins a little bit more, a little bit longer until we can finish our sports seasons, I think that's a great idea. Wanted to talk about protocol now and what you voted on. And I spoke with Samantha from the CDC outbreak team today. If you missed my number, or my email, grade school is again in outbreak status. As I shared before, we're polling again, said so we're going to go back to the old definition. We reset all the schools. Nobody was outbreak status coming back from vacation. 2 weeks later, we are back into outbreak status. I asked her when she was announcing that the new definition or the return to the old definition for outbreak status, what does that mean? And she said, really, doesn't mean anything. So I asked Samantha at CDC the same thing today. We found out yesterday we were in outbreak status at the grade school. What does that mean? She said, really nothing. And she had spoken with Melissa yesterday, and Melissa had shared what you guys had decided about we wouldn't be beyond the guidelines by saying anybody who is positive needs, before they can return to school on days 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, have to show prove a negative test in order to get back to schools on days 6 through 10. She thought that was great. She said, I'm going to take note of that. So kudos to you guys for thinking that. I'm surprised somebody else hadn't thought of it. So I sent a letter, I mailed it out to the school committee and the administrative team today, and Jolene is going to get it out to her parents. It's not even a requirement of the outbreak team that we let our parents know, but clearly our parents want to know. So even though there's nothing to be done with the fact of outbreak status, we just felt that letting them know is really important to do. And I guess the last thing on this part before we need to discuss the possibility or the recommendation to suspend contact tracing, which is coming from the CDC
as well in the DOE. I sent out an email to the administrative team, asked them what they thought about us removing the requirement for all of our subs to be vaccinated, and I think everybody sort of had the same reaction, which is not thrilled about it, but given our shortage, given the fact that they're going to be masked and probably no more threat than anybody else, that we should do that. So unless there's rejection from the school committee, then I think we should do that, and I want to send that information out. I bet, should know that, I forgot to say this, I had multiple people who used to be on our sub list who are not vaccinated call and say, given the way things have changed, can we change that? Because I really want to come back to sub. It's like, yeah, I think that's a great idea.
In addition to that, what about parent volunteers?
I think we still want to try and, on some level, limit the mixing cohorts. I want to take it kind of slow. And we're not even getting many volunteers yet, still at the grade school anyway, which is where most of them are.
For the teachers who are not vaccinated, are they in pool testing, or is that optional for teachers who are not vaccinated?
Still optional, and by the way, I'm sure you all know this by now, but the Supreme Court struck down the President Biden's recommendation for vaccinating or once a week testing. So, no, we do not have a requirement. And I would say we still have over 90% of our staff that are vaccinated, and I would say in my up until the last day or two, we probably have pretty close to 100% who are in pool testing, either vaccinated or in pool testing. I think there are at least a couple I'm aware of that have chosen to stop doing pool testing.
Sure.
That's their choice.
All right.
So last thing we need, sorry, you ready?
I'm just thinking.
Can I move on?
Yeah, go
ahead. Well, so, the CDC is, or now permits, that schools that are universally masked to suspend contact tracing. I don't know if Jeannie wants to speak to this, or who's on here, but or Dr. McConnell, but it's a huge amount of work. The Omicron is, as I said, very fast moving, and it basically takes up all the time, and I don't want to say it feels like a waste of time. Not a waste of time, it's almost an impossible task. So a lot of schools are choosing to go with the suspending the contact tracing, and I would recommend that you do that as well.
So I will entertain a motion to suspend contact tracing for the Winthrop Public Schools as permitted by the Maine Center for Disease Control in their memo dated January 12, 2022. So moved.
Seconded.
Thank you, Jeff. Okay. Discussion. I kind of have two warring thoughts going on, and I've discussed them with the two of you. My first thought is, well, if this current variant is moving so fast that by the time contact tracing is done, it's already been spread wherever it's going to be spread, is it worth the time? And then my other just as strongly held thought is, how do we tell parents of close contacts to be more vigilant, to look for symptoms if they don't know that their kids have been close contacts, if we're not telling them at all? And one of the things I was wondering was, is contact tracing as a whole, is it cumbersome because there's data entry to the CDC?
Not at all.
Okay. So it's just telling those parents that they're a close contact?
Yeah. And the amount of time that is spent doing just that, and again, and it's that whole sense of, by the time you make the contact, let them know. And I don't mean to put Jolene on the spot, but you do pretty regular communications home with the whole school staff or with the individual, with the classrooms where they are. How do you do that?
Well, because we've had so many cases
at grade school more frequently. Am I not talking about that?
Right.
It's this, the blowout, and it started last year too. So we've had so many cases at the grade school most recently that it's almost like it is impossible to try and keep up with it. There's not enough hours to, logistically to even do it. So I have been sending letters home, paper copies, plus emailing the families in classrooms where we have been having COVID cases. And the letters will say, there's been a COVID case in your child's room, or it will say, there's been two more cases, or it might say, now your child's teacher, like some of the teachers want me to say, tell my kids that I am COVID positive. So the letter's been specific to say, and there's a growing number of who it might be. And I have told parents to consider their kids close contacts, because we just have so much of it that I just ask them to consider their kids close contacts and specifically to watch very closely for symptoms.
So I guess that was kind of one of my questions, one of my thoughts. If asking potentially two people, Jeannie and Melissa, to do the majority of this work is a lot, I mean, it's a lot, would it be easier to have the classroom teacher reach out to the parents and say, kid X is positive, these three kids around kid X are close contacts?
I'm shaking my head no, Kelly, because Melissa and I do the contact tracing together, and we spend hours doing that. And I don't know, I can't speak to middle school and high school, but at the grade school, we have to look at the classroom, we look at the cafeteria, we look at all the CEs, and then we have to reach out to all those people. And so the classroom teacher only has one prep each day. And they need to do planning during that time. There's no way they have time to do that. Melissa doesn't have time to do it, and really I don't either. We do it after school. So a lot of the contact tracing, I do it either at home, and Melissa and I text, because I have a lot of things digitally, and then we reach out to teachers. So it's just ginormous, the amount of work and time. And with the number of cases right now, it doesn't seem like it may be beneficial to try and contact trace, because by the time we're done doing it, and right now we wouldn't be able to do it in an evening. Before, when we would have like 10 to 15, we would work, we were working 7 days a week to keep up with it. Right now, I wouldn't even be able to contact trace by midnight and have it done. So, and as quick as it's spreading, I think parents better be watching their children very closely, because not only are they getting exposed here, they're getting exposed in the community. I mean, it's everywhere. It's not. And it's spreading, like, I mean, we know that, like you were saying, people that have the vaccinations and are boosted, they're still, I mean, I had over a few weeks ago, vaccinated and boosted. So, it's a logistic nightmare, and it's not even feasible.
Yeah. Have you heard any feedback from parents or teachers or anybody with your kind of your classroom communication? Because to me, that sounds like a really good solution.
Yeah, I get, because I encourage them to reach out to me if they have any questions, and people do.
Yeah,
they email me and reach out to me. They want to know, like, they sometimes it's specific questions, like when was the day of positive, you know, exposure kind of thing. And so yes, they do. They ask me, and some of the questions are, well, does this mean my child can't come back to school?
Right.
And I answer the emails. I mean, as soon as they come back, I send right back out, oh, no, there's no quarantining, there's only isolating. Right. So your child's been exposed, but can be here at school.
I think it's a really great solution.
So I guess the question is for Mark and Sue Violet. Would something like that work at the middle and high school, where you send a message that says, there was an outbreak in this class? Since your kids are moving so much, they're not stable like they are at the grade school. Would that
in the high school, when we do it, it's definitely at least 7 different rooms that are impacted, the homeroom and the classes that they're in. So it can't hit me. Never heard anybody say they can't hit me. So it's like Jolene said, it just takes so much time. And when Jeannie was up and we were out for Christmas break, Ari and I earned that pay that we could be making one call home and make it crazy.
But would it be feasible to send a letter or an email either home that says, you know, Miss So-and-so's block one class for this whatever had an outbreak, consider your child a potential close contact?
So I think what I heard more than anything was the parents were appreciative of the call, but they were already expecting their kids from home every day to be as close contact. Because it was so, you know, and everybody knew that it was going to the high school.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. So, thank you. How about the middle school, Sue?
Jeannie wants to speak.
Oh, yeah, sure. Jeannie?
Well, just brief, I agree. It is a little different than middle school, high school, because we don't have classrooms, so we can't send out that the kids are mobile. And also lots of, like, today, for instance, we had a positive come in about 3 o'clock, 2:30 this afternoon. And I tried sending out just emails, like a canned response. I've gotten through about half of them, and after I get off the Zoom, I have to do the rest. And we're not telling folks to quarantine anymore. It's kind of almost like a courtesy call. So that's why I feel like the amount of work and time and how fast this is going, and like when the pools come in on Friday night, Saturday morning, you know, it's a long, and I'm not afraid of work. I'm not afraid of doing the job till it's done on weekends, but the amount of hours on the weekends and evenings for this now, when I'm just calling to tell them, your child doesn't have to stay home, they can still come to school, there's nothing different. But it just, for me, it's kind of a breaking point. And I think last week, I think Mark and Ari got a good taste of what contact tracing is. Now, when I was out with COVID, sick with COVID, fully vaccinated and boosted from an unvaccinated contact. But I would love to see that, you know, that we accept that recommendation of the DOE and NASA. They put a lot of time and work into their recommendations, and I do think it's time to suspend it maybe. And, you know, if we need to bring it back, if our quarantine rules change, I'm happy to see the need to do that. But right now, it is work heavy. It is really work heavy for us.
Sue, are you there?
Yes, I am.
So the question, Sue, was, you know, what kind of feasibility could you see in notifying parents not doing a full contact tracing, but just saying somebody in your kid's class is positive? And
it's hard because the kids are all over the building, like they are at the high school. So that makes the contact tracing piece incredibly difficult. We have to look at seating charts, and if it's phys ed, then it's everybody in the class. And like Jeannie was saying, we're not notifying them because they have to quarantine. So at this point, it is this courtesy call saying, be on the lookout for symptoms. And at this point, with the speed at which this variant spreads, I think everybody should assume that they've been a close contact. And everybody should be monitoring for symptoms all the time. And I put in my last, I don't know how many weekly newsletters, if the child's not feeling well, please keep them home. Let's just keep monitoring. And I think that is our most effective tool right now, because trying to determine who was sitting within this many feet of whom during which class takes up so much time that things have already spread past that, you know, by the time we make contact. So I don't see where the contact tracing is giving us the effect it gave us early on.
And I just wanted to echo kind of what they said, but especially at the middle and the high school, contact tracing is not the entire classroom. So So to send a letter to the entire class would almost be unnecessary because we have all our desks spaced out purposefully so that not all kids in that classroom are necessarily in close contact to the kids who were positive. So that would actually create more work if we were sending it out to more people. But I also really, really want to advocate that we should not put this on teachers. I just feel like there's a lot of stress and there's a lot of stuff going on, and I would really, really hate to see this being added to teachers' plates.
Thank you.
And Melissa.
Melissa.
Hi. So I can definitely echo everything that Jolene said, for sure. And I agree with Ariel, like, not putting it on the teacher's plate. I mean, and I agree, Kelly, it is a lot on myself and Jeannie and admin, for sure. We get that. And I do have to say, with the classroom letters that Jolene has amazingly has done to that, I know there's some, I'm sure there's pros and cons to everything that you're going to decide tonight, but I have gotten some email questions, and I know, obviously, Jolene has. And one of the top questions is, when was the last exposure? So I think to just put the exposure date in there, and Jolene and I kind of had a conversation, I think, today at some point during our craziness that we've been dealing with. But I think for the most part, everyone has to assume they've been exposed. I mean, at this point, we have, what, 75 cases since January 3rd at the grade school tonight, as of tonight. So that number right there tells me it's literally through the whole school and then some, right? And in our community. So the only thing that I haven't had a chance to like talk about, but we have to think about our daycare. So I think some families are amazing and they call me and they say, okay, my child needs to quarantine outside of school, right? Like they shouldn't go to daycare unless they've been vaccinated. So, you know, our little kindergartners, like, my daughter is vaccinated, but I obviously tell her daycare. I'm like, okay, she's been exposed multiple times. She just had a negative pool. She has no symptoms, but if anything comes up, please let me know. Obviously, I'm very proactive, but I know one daycare provider called me yesterday, I think it was, and she said, I'm really worried because I have some families that will tell me, and then I have some families that don't tell me, and I'm concerned because is this class a high risk in your view? So I'm not sure what that answer would be. It would be maybe like, hey, there's exposures in these classrooms. I don't know. I don't know what the answer is on that end because at this point, we have to assume everyone is in close contact. I mean, there's no doubt in my mind. I can tell you there's a positive and positives in literally every classroom. So I'm not sure. And it doesn't need to be decided, but I think the letters are amazing. It is too much for Jeannie and I to try to contact every single parent or instant alert. Dorian has been good about that, but it's just too much. So that's just, especially the surge right now. When we go back to the, you know, maybe five cases or something, then that would be definitely feasible. But I can tell you it's too much. It's a lot of work.
So perhaps what we can do is vote on this question about the suspend contact tracing, and then we can brainstorm as a administrative team if there are things that we want to do, what you're suggesting.
Before we do that, Tim and Joe, neither of you have any comments or questions?
Joe, you muted.
Some days I'll learn. This is a really good discussion, and I have a great deal of concern about our staff as well as our children as to how big this has become. So, quite frankly, I wasn't initially inclined to vote for this motion, but I now can better understand how we just don't have the ability to do the contacts and get them there and useful about that. So I think I will vote yes.
I want to just piggyback on that because this is really, and this is, again, part of my education in the last couple of weeks. It's about time. By the time it's
done, it's, we're on something else. There's no end to it. So you can see in everything that I write, everything that the administrators send home, we always say, if your child is symptomatic, please keep them home. And you know, I think it's sometimes working and sometimes it's not.
Yes. Tim, did you have anything to add before we take a vote?
No, I agree. I think this is way too much work on the staff. It's just, it's not getting us any better. We're all getting it right now, everywhere.
Yes, we are, Tim.
Okay, so let's take a vote. All those in favor?
To suspend.
To suspend contact tracing at the Winthrop School District.
And we can't see you, so you voting, can you tell us how you're voting?
Oh, my video's on.
Oh, you are on there. You keep moving around my screen.
So that is unanimous. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you all for the great discussion. I think we got a lot of good information out of that. Okay. New business. Calendar consideration.
Yeah, this is actually a two-part conversation. One of it has to do with update you on where things stand. When I wrote my initial notes to myself, I said that we're unlikely with 2 days that would be the non-school days and Thanksgiving to be waived, and I'm still, I would say it's a toss in the coin right now. But initially the commissioner was saying not likely, and not just for me, I wasn't specifically about talking about Winthrop. Recently, a number of schools have got these kinds of days approved. I was going to say to you that my plan was to wait till March or April so we had some idea what the number of snow days are, but subsequently, working with Aaron Weeks, I think we've worked that out so we can continue to do snow days would be remote days, you know, with remote learning days and not have to be added at the end. So two parts here. So just for this year, 21-22, I guess because of what has recently come up, I think I'm going to request from the commissioner by the end of, I will request by the end of the week for those 2 days to be waived, not made up at all. And I think we have a better chance of doing that now, but I just want people to be clear that they're not crazy about doing that. And unfortunately, they're not crazy about doing that with systems like ours, that our calendar, we're up on June 9th, which is relatively early. So, but part of what we talked about was trying to have a calendar with a definitive end so it doesn't get all over the place, you know, move all over the place, people can make plans, all that kind of stuff. So I wanted to know, I'm going to submit for that day. January 7th, which last week, we will definitely have to make that day up. I had a conversation with Kelly and Sue about that. I talked to the association. People are right now brainstorming some ideas. I talked about what some of those might be. From my perspective, I'm hoping as we move forward that we don't have any more true snow days the rest of the year, that they will be remote learning days. And I think we, as I said in my meeting this afternoon, I think we've dotted the I's and crossed the T's now so that we can make sure that happens, which means we have one snow day to make up. And I would suggest that if we don't have any more snow days, the true snow days, that we just re-extend school to Friday. Everyone's school right now till Thursday. Let's just go to Friday. So again, I don't need you to make a decision on that tonight. But I think we do need to see if I have any idea what I'm talking about and get us through March without using any more true snow days. But that's kind of what, that's the first part of this, is a bigger part.
Couple of questions for that. Number one, what do you think you'll hear back about those two
November
days?
It usually takes a couple weeks.
Okay, and then number two, if we moved it to Friday, basically, Thursday would become a full day, Friday would be a half day?
Correct.
Okay. So
related to that, I mean, if I should say this, Teresa, don't admonish me if I wasn't supposed to say this, but when I met with the association, one of the things we talked about
is we have a comp day in April for parent-teacher conferences, and the question was, what if we didn't do a second parent-teacher conference? I personally would never put a second parent-teacher conference in the calendar. I think they're a waste of time. So I think we had some conversation about where does that expectation come from? But from my perspective, if we didn't do the second parent-teacher conference, we made that day up. We had that was the day the comp day is on. I can finally make that up as a student day. I think that would be great. Did you have another question on that?
No, just two.
Okay. All right. So the second part of this is really important. To get whatever feedback you guys have for me here is we've got the CAPSI regional calendar, and we're supposed to follow that as closely as possible because we lose funding if we don't, blah, 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 kind of stuff. So what I'd like to suggest, and if I thought of it this year, is part of the learning. When I build next year's calendar, I think I'm going to add in, I'd like to suggest I add in 5 days. So essentially schedule 180. It still would be my intent to do remote snow days as remote days. And so I don't think anybody's going to object to, if we're supposed to get out on June 15th, we end up getting out on June 10th, I don't think anybody's going to come tearing any of our doors down. So I'm very confident in saying that we would never use more than 5 doing the snow day, remote day thing. Maybe we do that. Maybe 5 is even too many. Auburn, for instance, where my wife works, does 3. They do 3, they put 3 days in there. Once it in, and they have actually used 2 snow days. If they go beyond 3, they're all remote. I personally like 5. I plan on the higher end.
Isn't that what we used to do?
We did. But I just want to clarify that was, I think, in the past, it was a...
Kind of had to,
because
you didn't have it on
Monday. Yeah, but it wasn't even that. I never liked that. I always liked putting out the calendar and we just added until... Then that's what kind of came up with, well, parents have a hard time sort of doing that, but for me, we have a 175-day student calendar a year. To artificially put, and that's what people say, well, we've already built in 10 days, or we built in 6 days, or we built in 5 days. It was sort of a sense of that's when school will end. So, yes, the answer is yes, that is what we used to do. But I just want to be really clear that we're building 180 days in. Hypothetically, we could then say with the schools need a day for professional development. That wasn't in the original schedule. Say, we need a day, we need a presenter that's coming in, we got this, whatever. So we just say there's no school on X day, and it doesn't affect the end date, correct. Megan, do you agree?
I know that's how my school used to work.
Yeah. That's how pretty much all of them do.
I mean, I guess as a student, I felt pretty good when we got out 5 days earlier than expected.
It felt better to get out earlier than have to go later.
Yeah, agreed. So I'm not saying, I just wanted to, that's what I'm thinking. That's what's kind of being discussed. I'm really kind of surprised, I probably shouldn't say this publicly, but we have a neighboring school district who started this whole remote learning thing, and they're not doing it anymore. Like, I don't get it. We've sort of made it clear and clear about what you need to do. We jumped through all those hoops and whatever the case may be. So I know that somebody out there listening to this on Zoom would say, well, the remote days aren't nearly as good as the in-person learning days, and they're right. But the reality is, if you add those on in June, I don't think they're any more effective than taking them as a remote day and whatever it is. So I think it's 6.5 dozen another, my thought. Your decision now. So anyway, I just wanted to share that with you before I start putting together the 22-23.
I guess the only question I have kind of looking at our high school students is how would that impact graduation date?
What we still would do, and this is what I've done other places, they really become lax on if you don't meet the required number of days, not probably the 165?
For 170.
For seniors, 170?
170 for seniors.
170. Okay.
If, in the past where I've been, because we want to, it's a little different here in Winthrop because we have people in our own gym, but other places where we don't think we do it off campus, it's never been, we've never been held to it. So I don't believe if we do it this way, I would still say to Mark, base it on 170 and set your date accordingly, and you should be fine.
Okay, great. I was just thinking, if I were senior graduating, there's no way you could get me to come back.
I think that's pretty much the sentiment everywhere, so. Although Caroline would like to stay next for 2 weeks.
Lies.
I could do that.
Good thinking. So anyway, I'm not looking for any action from you guys tonight, I just wanted to know what my thinking was and why I was thinking that way.
Are there any public comments?
Mike?
That's a deal.
There are?
Deanna.
I can't hear you.
Deanna, welcome to.
Deanna, okay. Deanna?
Yes, can you hear me?
I can, thank you.
Sorry, this is the first time I've ever spoken on school committee, but I teach second grade to grade school for anybody who doesn't know me, but I just, number one, want to piggyback on and say thank you to anyone who advocated not to add contact tracing to the teachers' plates. You know, as you all know, there's so much already on teachers' plates, and I really think that we are working super hard to also include our students who are already quarantined in our classroom remotely or providing work if their families really want that, if the child is not, you know, extremely ill or a family member is not extremely ill. There's a lot of moving pieces, so I do really appreciate the advocating against that. And what I really wanted to just comment on was, I think it's important to know, I know just speaking from grade school level, how appreciative we all are of our administration this year. I'm speaking, you know, from personal terms, my daughter was quarantined 5 times due to daycare exposure just in September. And every single time she's quarantined, Julian and Debbie have been incredibly supportive, and it's hard for me to be out. I'm not a teacher that's typically out regularly, but and I thank them via email, but I do think that it's hugely important that the committee knows that they are supporting their staff. I mean, to the highest degree. I just feel like that's important to be known, and how thankful we are for Nurse Melissa for everything that she is doing as well. So that's mostly a personal comment, but I did want to share that because I've had multiple discussions with my husband and have said, like, it is stressful and hard for me to be away from my students. My daughter's health is priority, of course. Thankfully, she stayed healthy, but it would be 10 times harder if I did not have the support from admin and colleagues at school. And our grade school team is extremely strong, and I have been very thankful for that. So I just want to share that.
Thank you, I appreciate that. Anyone else, Mike? No, okay. All right, school committee comments. Me too, sure, we'll start with you. You're not used to going first, you're used to going last. I looks like Joel left, so I just wanted to make a comment. He had talked about some of our athletes that went to the NBC indoor track in place, and I just wanted to know if you knew their names. I would like to acknowledge their accomplishments. Do either of you two know who the three students were?
No.
I don't know.
No. Well, congratulations. That was a first for Winthrop High School. Maybe if you could get those names, it would be nice to know who they were so I could acknowledge them by name. That's it. Joe? Do you have any comments, Joe?
There he is. He's good. You're in.
Well, I'd like to apologize to being a little bit late. Part of my problem is that we just switched to new computers and we didn't put the Zoom on. And then I had to go back to a little laptop to figure out how to do that. It I was here earlier, but I think the one thing I'd like to say is I continue to hear from people who live in our community that are telling me that they really appreciate our willingness to take and talk with them, as well as trying to get communication out with them. And those are two things that I stress for many years. We're a lot safer if we do things and show people what we are doing, because then they'll better understand. And I really appreciate having teachers and everyone else tell us about what's really all going on. And just a big shout out to the staff and all the work and able to do what they're doing in the community service. That's all I have.
Thank you, Joe. Tim, do you have any comments?
Yes, one comment. I know we've had discussion on remote learning, what happens when students go out, and what that looks like. But I would just like to shout out Julia Thompson, fourth grade teacher. My boy went out yesterday, sitting there with me, and I get an email that night, and he's on Google this morning, full day classroom. So it was A plus telling her and shows what they're doing at the school. And that's it.
Thank you. How
about one of the just started rehearsing, putting together everything. NHS is working on a charity service project. And I mentioned last meeting that the outing club was going on a trip on the 15th, and that was rescheduled because it was like 0 degrees, that's happening this Saturday, so I still, again, encourage anyone who's interested to join. And I also wanted to say that, considering everything that's going on in the world, I think overall it's a very successful first semester. I thank all of you and all the staff at all the schools for making that happen.
Thank you. Yeah. Could you be willing to that in an email to me, it's, I can't write all.
Oh, yeah. I had the same thing all over again, but I wrote down a little bit more information. There's three different projects that NHS has appointed liaisons for to get in touch with people in the community, and as well as the Navajo Nation, which I'm the liaison for. We're doing a service project to donate. We're asking them what they need, but for the most part, the idea of books and crafts, so they have a mobile library that goes around because they don't have access to a stationary library. So we're excited about that. And 1X, as Emily said, is a full thing. We have picked Ona, we have passed it, and we had our first read-through today. It was very, very fun.
Where do you go?
It's a 1X called Look Me in the Eyes, and it's set in the future. It's a drama.
You don't have to tell me anymore.
I really like it. It gives off like kind of a Hunger Games vibe, which I think is so cool, but it's not as dark.
Same thing, can you drop that down, send it to me so I can include it? Much better for you.
Can I ask you a question about the National Honor Society project? Are you going to be seeking donations for these places?
Yes.
Okay. Great.
We just went through my son's library and have so many books to donate.
Yeah.
So, I don't know if this is for you from Ms. Shaw, but I know it's early, it's only January, but are members of the NHS still planning to come to?
I wrote that down and they forgot to say yes. The seniors have all been told that it is something that is very much wanted and pushing toward expected of them.
Awesome. That'd be awesome.
I'll make you it.
Yep.
One of the three projects that NHS is working on is to adopt a garden somewhere in Winthrop. So I'm the liaison for that. And so we're trying to find connections to the Winthrop Garden Club. So if anyone has any information about that, that would also be very helpful.
Can you, in your, since it's not new at this point, can I talk to you at some point?
So, yeah, give me
I'm just thinking, like, our church used to adopt the municipal park thing lot, and we're not doing that anymore, and we know who that contact person is, so I think that's beneficial.
And Rotary is very interested in pairing with middle school and high school to do something with gardening, whether it's food or flowers or whatever. And the grade school already does it, right?
It does sound, but I'd be interested in more information, so.
You might also talk to Fred Kitchener, because I know he was big on edible gardens. Fred Kitchener? Aren't you glad you said something?
I was gonna ask Joe if he was being.
He does know quite a lot. Wow. Again, a wonderful amount of discussion and debate and thinking about all aspects of possibility, and I appreciate that. I hope the teachers didn't get too scared when I asked if it would be easier for them to provide that. It's just a thought. One of the things that I noticed kind of as a theme going in, especially the elementary school and the middle school administrator reports, was about kindness and acceptance. And I know that that's something that the high school also works a lot on. And I just, I love that. That's not something that happened when I was in school, that it was, you know, even spoken about, really. And so I love that that's happening, and that it's being brought to the forefront that it's important, you know, starting at a very young age and working all the way up. So thank you all for everything, and I think that's it for me. Did you have anything else to say? Okay. There is no executive session tonight, so without objection, I will declare the meeting adjourned at 8:23.